All right, we are recording. Where's my jingles? Let's play some cards.
Where's my jingles?
See, we're working on his brow chakra. We're just in back of the crown chakra.
One. Hello and welcome to Waxing the Porpoise. We are here again to talk about the Limey. This is episode 10 now. This film was made in 1999. You got your host, Jim G Baby, joined as always by the usual suspect, Steve. How are you, friend?
Great, friend. Good to see you again.
Likewise, as always. How are you doing?
Doing good. Before I watched this movie, I wasn't sure what year it was made, and it was driving me nuts because it somehow looks older than it is and like more modern than it is. Like, cause at one point the gal pulls out a cell phone. I was like, holy shit. So this is during cell phone times because you could have convinced me it was early '90s. And then when I saw the cell phone, I was like, shit, well maybe it's like late '90s, early 2000s. And then there was a random clip where they showed George Clooney and he had that super dark hair. And so that kind of narrowed it in like, okay, this has got to be late '90s. And then afterwards, the first thing I looked up was what fucking year did this come out? And then 99, I was like, oh, thank God that makes sense then.
Yeah. It's got a distinctive feel to it. And it does like that late '90s, early aughts is kind of an interesting reflecting on it back now. It's kind of an interesting time period because it's, we have had internet at that point for 5 or 8 years, at least to the masses. But cell phones haven't quite blown up, so people are probably still using pagers and like Nokia cell phones that have Snake on them and shit still. So it hasn't really broken into, it's probably another 5 or 8 years before we have like the first smartphone. So it's riding this kind of weird edge of technology, but I like that kind of vibe of it. Like it does feel like it could have been 1992 for all we know, or it could be 2000.
Yeah, it's always annoying when movies try to be super super modern.
Mm-hmm.
and I mean it never ages well. It's like if you made one today and you reference some hit band that in 5 years, it's like who are they talking about? It, you know, it's
like the new,
it's timeless, if you will.
Makes me think of like the new Radicals.
Ah, yes. Circa 96, 97, 98.
Yeah, somewhere in there. Yeah, I like it. This is like a very analog kind of film sprinkled with kind of some modern stuff into it. But you know, another, it's funny you brought that up, that you've seen A Time to Kill, right? With McConaughey and Samuel L.
No.
Oh God, I should have known, but fuck man, you've never seen A Time to Kill. God damn. So that movie was made in 96 and it's set in the same year like that it was made, and I swear the first time I watched that, all the way up until maybe the halfway point of the movie, maybe even 2/3 of the way through that movie, I thought it was like segregation era, like late '60s, like early '70s. And then you see like, you know, someone's, I think it's Sandra Bullock. She's like jogging and it says like property of Reebok. And it's like, I was like, oh shit. And I remember I had to turn to like my stepdad. And I was like, wait, is this supposed to be like modern, like set in the modern day when it was filmed? And he's like, yeah. I was like, what? Like, because it deals with, like, it's in, like, deep South, and it's dealing with, like, race relations. Like I thought it was, like, Mississippi Burning. Like, it took place in, like, 1964. It's wild. That's, goddamn, I can't believe you haven't seen
it. Yeah, I haven't seen Mississippi Burning either, but I guess.
We are lost.
I also would have assumed, because, yeah, it kind of has that vibe of old school, sweaty courtroom seersucker in the South, like Lord.
Yeah,
Lord.
It's crazy. Like, yeah, it's like you're stepping into like a time capsule kind of movie. And then, yeah, when it comes in later on, it's like, oh yeah, it's supposed to be 96. It's like, no way. But
the only thing I know about that movie is I think at the end there's like a what if it was a white girl or something that's supposed to be like a big punch.
Yeah, that is a big punch too when you watch it. It's like, yeah, McConaughey is like closing argument in that. So good. Yeah, if you're a fan of like courtroom stuff and like revenge and like race relations and like the deep South.
I mean, I've always heard it's a good movie.
It's so good. It's excellent. It's top tier McConaughey, Samuel L for sure. I highly recommend you watch it. I don't know if I would ever, well, maybe at this point, you know, it's kind of, I guess you could consider it a deep cut because it's not talked about very much, but it's super good. And same with Mississippi Burning. That's Gene Hackman and Willem Dafoe. Earlier role for Willem Dafoe. That's a really good one. That one's actually is set in like the 60s, the civil rights movement, right in the thick of it, like SNCC workers and like, you know, burning crosses in the front yard and like, you know, the whole nine yards. Both of those flicks are fucking excellent.
So this movie, The Limey, I put in the category of movies that if I told you I hadn't seen it, you'd be like, oh, well, yeah, I mean, that's not super surprising. You should check it out.
Yeah.
A Time to Kill is one of those fun movies that I can't wait to tell you I haven't seen it because I know you're just going to be beside yourself, yeah. Indignant, and yeah. You did not disappoint.
Yeah, totally. Yeah, I could totally. Yeah, The Limey, like I knew for sure you hadn't seen it. But yeah, like, just in the course of this conversation, like I took it for granted. Like, oh, yeah, everyone's seen A Time to Kill. Come on.
Everyone's seen The Fifth Element.
Fifth Element's a banger. I feel like that is one most people should see or should have seen by this point. God damn you. So this is a first time watch for Steve. I've seen this movie probably 20 times. This is probably in that era when I was working at Blockbuster and I just happened to see it. And I noticed that it was directed by, Steven Soderbergh, who he's pretty big director. I don't know if you'd call him an auteur director.
What?
But so it's like,
what does that mean?
So it's like someone who is like well known and crafts like thought provoking, thoughtful, meticulous films, I guess. This is my interpretation of the word auteur. I'm probably not using it correctly.
Okay.
So you probably know, you know, Traffic. Have you ever heard of the movie Traffic with Benicio del Toro?
Yeah, I think I have. I think I've seen it.
Catherine Zeta-Jones.
Yeah.
She dips beneath
the laser.
Yeah, she's in it. Michael Douglas, Don Cheadle.
Yeah. I'm pretty sure I saw it around the time it came out, but
yeah, that's probably his biggest claim to fame. Just like,
well, the name sounded general. Familiar, but I couldn't think of anything else. I didn't click to see what else he had done.
He's worked a lot with George Clooney. They're pals. He made his breakout with Sex, Lies, and Videotape, which is, a really good flick. That's kind of what that was, his breakout. And then what else has he done? He's done a lot of really good shit. So Sex, Lies, and Videotape in 89. That was his breakout.
Did he do the West Wing? Or what am I thinking of?
You're thinking of Aaron Sorkin.
Whatever.
Yeah, I'm not a West Wing guy, which is probably sacrilege to some people, but it's like, yeah, get
whatever,
fucked.
Fuck off, listen to something else.
Yeah, his next thing, he had a kind of a slew in like the early 2000s, so he did, actually, I'm probably misspeaking with Traffic. His probably most mainstream well-known, he did the first Ocean's 11 in 2001.
Okay,
so, yeah, I've seen that. But yeah, so he did Sex, Lies, and Videotape 89, and then he kind of did some like funky pictures that I've never seen, and I'm looking through his filmography that I'm not familiar with, even in like the film zeitgeist. But so he did, the next biggest film he did was, have you ever seen Out of Sight with George Clooney and J-Lo?
No. Is that the one where somebody's blind?
No.
Or, wait, no, I'm thinking of, what's that shitty, it's a shitty Val Kilmer movie around that same time where somebody's, where he's blind or...
Yeah, you're thinking of, fuck.
Is it called At First Sight?
Maybe. Without looking it up, it sounds right. But yeah, it's like Val Kilmer and like Mira Sorvino, I think. Yeah, I've never seen that. I just remember the trailer. But,
so no, Out of Sight. No, I have not seen that.
Okay. That's a one you should watch one day when you get a chance. It's really good. It's got a Pulp Fiction vibe, minus the characteristic like Tarantino flair that marks all of his films. It's that kind of story. Or it feels like that to me. Steve Zahn's in it too. I think you're a Zahn fan. I'm a big Steve Zahn fan.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
He's good in it. Ving Rhames. Yeah, Out of Sight's really good. Actually, I had in my notes the Limey feels similar to Out of Sight in some ways. Huh. I think that's probably more of the like Soderbergh's directorial style. That's like his stamp on it, which felt similar. The Limey is very much its own thing, as we'll discuss. But then, yeah, he did The Limey right out of Sight. Then he did Aaron Brockovich, Traffic, Ocean's 11. So that kind of, that was like, he was riding the rocket ship right there, you know. He actually also did another movie with George Clooney in 2002 that I would like to cover on this cast. It was a remake. I think it's, the original was Andre Tarkovsky. I'm probably butchering his last name, but it was kind of controversial because it's that film, Solaris, was directed in like the 70s, was like a well-known, it's like it stands alone too by itself as a really good picture, but he made a remake of it, and I actually, probably sacrilege again, I actually like his remake better than the original. But yeah, Solaris is badass. And then he did Ocean's 12 and Solaris. He did Ocean's 12, Ocean's 13, which seems weird for a director like this to like go back and it seemingly like a cash grab situation going for like a mainstream film. It seems like it clashes with his sensibilities and like the other things that he's made. It almost seems like a, the dude who made Pi, Darren Aronofsky. It's like if he all of a sudden made like a fucking Marvel movie and then went back to making like Pi and like The Fountain and shit like that, and then bounced back and made like a Marvel sequel. Maybe not quite to that extent, but kind of like that. It just seems weird for that kind of director to step out and be like, yeah, I'll do Ocean's 12 and Ocean's 13. Like, he later on, he did that.
I mean, the analogy makes sense to me. So I get what you're saying.
But yeah, anyway, so yeah, he's a really good director. And I like his style. I like the way he moves. And I think probably out of his whole catalog, I would say probably the top three are for me are like The Limey, Out of Sight, and Solaris are all up there. So I'm really excited to talk about The Limey actually, because as much as he's got his stamp on this film. It feels very without getting too pretentious, it feels very singular. Like it's got his stamp on it, but it's a very unique film, and I think it's one of his best pieces of work. So without further ado, I think too, like in the past, we haven't really gone through like a synopsis, as it were. But I guess for some context, because this movie is really weird the way it's shot and the way it moves. Maybe until you get to the midpoint, maybe the latter half, like the way it's edited and cut. But so, real quick synopsis. Basically, it's about a dude who's pretty older in age. So he probably had his daughter when he was older, probably like late 30s or something, because he looks like he's like 60, maybe even early 70s, would you say?
Yeah, he looks like a modern day 75, but a late 90s 63.
Right. Yeah, because like,
So yeah, if his, let's presume his daughter's 30, you know, had her at 33.
okay, so it's about him. It looks like he's been in and out of prison. He even mentions like I've been in prison half my life, if not more. So he's like a career criminal, like a thief. He's done a bunch of robberies, nicks. So it sounds like he just pulled a nickel in like Liverpool or somewhere, and while he's in the joint, his daughter, who lives in the States in LA, dies mysteriously, or it's claimed it was a car accident. So he finds out through the grapevine, and as soon as he gets out of the joint in the UK, he flies out because he thinks something's fishy about it. And so from there, it's pretty much a
Well,
straight.
he gets contacted by Louis Guzman's character, right? And it, from what I remember, it was sort of like a, hey, there's more to the story than this car accident. Because when I was thinking back on the movie, I was like, well, what made him think it was so suspicious? Like it was just a car accident. And then I was like, oh yeah, because he had that letter. And I don't remember if they went into
Yeah.
everything that was in it or if it was just like a, hey, I knew your daughter. You might want to hear some of this information I have, but yeah, good. Continue.
Yeah, and well, actually, to that point of order, I just watched the first half of this to refresh, and there's actually a really poignant part in the movie where the gal that he's palling around with in the States, he's talking about how he found out, and she mentions, so when did Eddie tell you, or is that how you knew, or something like that, Louis Guzman's character, and he's like, no, he's like, I knew before Ed. And he describes, like, it kind of gets into like the supernatural and like the
Oh
voodoo
yeah.
kind of stuff, where he's like, oh no, I knew before Ed. And he's like, I was doing something, and I felt he was trying to read a book, and he's thumbing through the pages, and he's like, I thought I was having a heart attack because like the pages were stuck together like glue. I couldn't flip through the pages. And he's like, all the blood like rushed out of my head, and people are like, you look like a ghost, like you turn pure white. And he's like, at that moment, I knew it must be my daughter Jenny, like something must have happened. So that kind of gets into that kind of woo-woo territory, but that's the only hint
Well,
of that
I
in
took that
this.
as him knowing that she died, but not necessarily under suspicious circumstances. And that's what I assumed the letter from Ed was like, hey, this isn't quite exactly what it seemed like, but
Fair. Yeah, I think it's like maybe it's kind of hinting into like a father's or a parent's intuition that something happened. Maybe not nefarious or otherwise, but he just got like a feeling. And then yeah, when he gets, so like his daughter Jenny has palled around with Louis Guzman's character Eduardo. He actually does You're correct. He sends him a letter saying, like, I don't think it ever goes into what's in the letter, but yeah,
I don't think it does either.
it makes it seem like, you know, he's trying to
I
tell
have
him,
some information or something.
yeah, like, because as we'll get into it, like, he knows that obviously, you know, this older dude who's super rich, Peter Fonda's character, there's something, he's got something around the eyes, you know, like, there's something fishy about him and her death. Because as you see, it's kind of a trend for Peter Fonda to shack up with these young 20, late 20s chicks, and he's like 60, 70. But
And
anyway.
I don't know anything about that dude as an actor, but he was like the perfect cast for that type of just kind of slimy, older, creepy dude who just kind of takes advantage of young gals. And yeah, so he definitely played the part.
He was perfect. And there's a couple points too that, like, in the film where he does a great job at emphasizing that creeper status.
Dude, just the part where he's like cleaning his teeth in the mirror, it just like gives you the shivers. Like, I was just watching it, like, gross. God, I cannot imagine being this like young, attractive gal and looking at this guy who's like doing that disgusting sound. Like, ugh. Sorry,
Yeah.
continue.
No, yeah, and he looks in the mirror and he does that weird thing where he like he grits and bares his teeth and he's just like, all right, I'm ready, you know, like, yeah, that definitely gives you the heebie-jeebies, you know, like, this guy is just such a fucking slime ball. Yeah, so just to wrap up what this damn thing's about, so he gets tipped off, something's going on, so he hops on to a plane, comes across the pond, and is like full investigate, like, revenge mode pretty much. He links up with Eduardo, played by Louis Guzman, who does not disappoint. It's kind of a subtle role for him, but I really like him as like his right-hand man. But so yeah, it's basically he goes on a one-man wrecking crew, a two-man hit wrecking crew with Louis Guzman, and it's a revenge film, him trying to find out what's going on with his daughter. And like, he guessed right, there is something, some fuckery afoot. It wasn't that she just, you know, died in a random car wreck, you know, there's some shit going on, and he tries to get to the bottom of it. And it goes through the kind of like this weird kind of seedy underbelly of LA, and like politics of, you know, a former like record executive is kind of what I gathered from what Peter Fonda's role was. But yeah, that's it in a nutshell. He's out for blood. He knows, or he's at least got a really he's got an intuition in him that something happened to his daughter and it wasn't right, and he's gonna get to the bottom of it and fucking punish whoever was responsible. So that's it. And so I guess the real quickly to the cast of characters, it's pretty eclectic mix of actors, but the lead is played by Terrence Stamp as Wilson, who I've talked to other people about, and they're real familiar with him, probably like people of an older age, because he's an older actor. But I thought he was excellent. He was great in it. Then you have Louis Guzman playing his kind of like man on the inside that's kind of helping him navigate LA as like fish out of water kind of thing. And then you have this other gal that also knew his daughter, that she's kind of serves the same capacity. And then you have Peter Fonda, who is the main antagonist to Terrence Stamp's Wilson, who was dating his daughter Jenny. And then there's a few other side characters. Probably my favorite one, and if I know you right, I think you'll agree. I really liked Nicky Catt, who was He's been in an episode of Friends, but people probably know him the most from
Boiler Room.
Boiler Room, or I was going to say...
That's where I recognized him from.
Okay. That's crazy. I'm glad you... It's good to know that you've seen Boiler Room. That's a good flick.
I love that movie.
Yeah, that's a great movie.
Just real quick tangent. I can't remember how it came up the other day, but I was just talking about Boiler Room, and that was like literally one of the first handful of DVDs I ever owned for a long time. So I've seen it so many times.
Yeah.
But somebody was telling me that there's a special feature on the DVD which shows an alternate ending. Are you familiar with this?
No.
Dude, okay, so just real quick, we don't have to go too far down this rabbit hole. It's a movie about like some shitty investment, whatever, stock, blah, blah, blah. The dude, the family man that Giovanni Ribisi's like screwing over, you know, right, like taking all of his money. The alternate ending is him showing up to the office with a gun and like Giovanni Ribisi's walking out for the last time and they like pass each other in the hall and he doesn't know it's him. So he's there to like kill him. But yeah, I haven't seen it cause I don't know where the DVD is and I couldn't find it anywhere online, but yeah, sounds like that was the alternate ending. Like instead of that guy getting his money back as one of his like last calls, you know, like, hey, I'm going to have them approve you selling whatever. It's been a while since I've seen it. But yeah, so the alternate ending was him showing up and just mowing everybody down in the office, which
damn.
Yeah, which I could see. And they were certainly building up to it.
Yeah.
Just showing the, anyway. So yeah, that guy that the two pool hall assassin guys were, that's where it sort of got a little bit less than ideal for me, I guess. Like
really?
So I really liked this movie at the beginning. It waned a little bit towards the three quarter mark. By the time it ended, I enjoyed it. I was trying to equate it to, like, in my mind, it was sort of like a Chili's or something where it's like not great. It's not exactly what you were expecting, but it's good. You know, it's fine. It's good enough. Like, it is what it is. You're not going there expecting fine dining or whatever, but I think it's because I enjoyed it so much towards the beginning, story-wise, and kind of the creative presentation of it. I liked some of the little foreshadowing things they did and some of the flashbacks and like flash forwards, and I really liked that part of it.
Mm-hmm.
Then when the DEA subplot came into it,
yeah,
I felt like this is the definition of we need to fill some time, so we'll just put in this little subplot. I didn't think it was really necessary to push a storyline along, and it was actually a little bit confusing. Like, okay, is he working for the DEA, or are they just following him because they see him interacting with the same characters? It wasn't really clear, and honestly, I didn't care enough about that portion of the plot to even like pause and think about it for a second. I was like, okay, let's just get on to the next thing, because there were so many cool parts that felt like it didn't belong. I mean, the part where, so when he first gets to town, he meets Ed, and Ed says, oh, you know, this is the guy she was dating, and, you know, a week or so before she died, she went down to this sketchy warehouse and was yelling at these dudes. So he's like, okay, well, I'm going to go down there and look into it, confronts them. They kick the shit out of him. He goes in, kills them all. Awesome. Love it. Yeah, I love that he left one guy alive to send the message. That's like biblical shit.
Yeah.
Tell him. You know, that was like, yeah, that was like a table setter. Like, okay, you know, I'm in at this point. And then,
yeah,
you know, when he's at the guy's party and he has those like fantasies about him going in and shooting him multiple times.
Yeah, and just
awesome,
blowing his brains out.
Yeah, so sweet. But the DEA thing, I thought was like, I didn't really care for it. But in the assassins, I don't know. I'm fine that they, you know, that they sent assassins after him to try to kill him, but I just didn't really like those two guys. They just kind of, I don't know. They kind of took me out of it a little bit, but
really, I'm surprised. I don't know if I was just,
yeah, I don't know. I think it's that fucking guy from Boiler Room. I just don't like him.
Really? I like him because I like to hate him. Like, I like to not like him.
He's because, very hateable.
Yeah. And the other film I was going to say before we got off on the Boiler Room tangent is I think most or a lot of people will recognize him more so from Dazed and Confused. Have you seen Dazed and Confused? Oh boy.
Yeah, I don't think so. I always confuse that one with Fast Times, and God. I really don't think I've seen either one all the way through.
You know, it's probably sacrilege to some people, but I think Fast Times is pretty overrated.
I've got the sacrilege counter up to 3 for this episode.
We're at 3. Already. Yeah, we're at 3. Yeah, I was thinking that in my head. I was like, what's another word? I think Dazed and Confused is a must watch. At this point, it's probably trite, but I got nostalgia and sentimental vibes for that flick, so I highly recommend it. But yeah, that guy, that assassin in this flick, the Limey, he plays a total asshole in Dazed and Confused, like alpha male, kind of like jock.
Kind of like a bully.
Yeah, total bully, yeah, piece of shit. Yeah, that's
kind of how he was, like, in Friends also. I forgot about that until you mentioned it, but that was the same dude.
And they steal his hat. Yeah, he's got that character down. I liked his character a lot as the assassin. Him and that other guy, he just seems like the village idiot. Like, you can't tell if he speaks English or not, and he's just like I don't know. He's a weird character in and of himself too, but like the mechanic. Mm-hmm. I like some of the it was a little bit of levity, I guess, to this film because it's got kind of a serious, like, I don't know. It's got a weird vibe. And there's not a lot of, like, comedic breaks, but the few that are there are from Nicky Katz's character as one of the assassins, the dude with the long hair. When he goes in and they're playing pool and he's like, he's like, we got next or something. Yeah, these are your quarters. He's like, and he fucking just throws them, dude. I love that part. That part cracks me up every time. He's like, he wants to break. Look how excited he is. Just let him break. Or like when they're having coffee and they're kind of like staking out, and just like his one-liners, like watching people. He's like, oh yeah, that's really important. They need that. I liked him a lot. I'm surprised.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that part was funny.
But the DEA stuff, I agree. It took me, I've seen this, you know, probably a lot more times than you, but it took like maybe the second or third time of that kind of like standing back and watching it from afar and seeing how, like, you know, the DEA subplot works in, and it's like, oh, okay. Because, yeah, the first time I'm like, what is this shit? It's coming out of fucking left field with these DEA guys all of a sudden targeting and brazing Wilson, who has no dog in this fight other than, like, he's just inserted himself into this greater plot, and it's like, why is he such a key target all of a sudden?
But they made it seem like he's working for the DEA, right? And they're the ones who, like, got him into the country. It's like, okay, why?
Yeah, that part falls flat. That's probably some rushed or just, like, you know, lazy screenwriting or lazy storytelling just to kind of cobble it together and like make it go.
Sort of explain how he was able to get into the country under an assumed name or something.
Yeah, something like that. It's probably one of those things, the more you try to examine it and look at it, the more it falls apart.
They were burning the bundles of heroin or whatever it was. Like, I don't think that's how you're supposed to get rid of it, because
no,
it just looked weird.
Yeah, I that head DA guy, I do like him though. That's Bill Duke, He's probably well, most well known for his character. I can't remember his
Which
name
guy?
in Predator. The head, the main DEA dude, bald dude. He's like, you know, you fucked up, right? Like when he's that interrogation scene.
The, let's see.
The head DEA guy, like the
Oh, the one that he
main.
like gives his badge to.
Yeah.
Is he bald?
Yes.
What does Marcellus Wallace look like?
Then why'd you try to fuck him like a bitch, Brett? Yeah, he's awesome in Predator. You've seen Predator, haven't you? God, dude, that movie's right up your fucking alley. You need to watch
Yeah.
Predator. It's a banger. Yeah,
That
he
has Arnold and
Jesse Ventura.
who's the other guy I'm thinking of? Not
Fuck.
Chubbs. Is it just Chubbs in it?
It is Chubbs, yeah, Carl Weathers.
Carl Weathers, yeah, okay.
Yep, he's in it. I can't remember who the other the side characters are. Shane Black is one of them, who is it's a weird, it's a rare acting role for him. He's probably better known as the screenwriter of Lethal Weapon, Lethal Weapon 2, and Kiss Kiss Bang Bang.
Okay.
Yeah, he's one of those weird guys that's like mainly a screenwriter and director, and then he's got a couple acting roles sprinkled in. Kind of not comparing him to Quentin Tarantino, but similar to like where Tarantino also has a couple acting roles. Like probably mainly most well known for is From Dusk Till Dawn.
Yeah.
But yeah, he's one of those weird
I really
people.
liked the first half of that movie. Or
Dusk
maybe
Till
it's the
Dawn.
first third. Yeah.
Yeah,
Before it gets all weird.
that's one of those films where it's like it's a completely different movie about that halfway, the latter third mark, and it's like, oh, this is like a crazy vampire balls to the wall horror movie. When before, yeah, it doesn't feel like that. But yeah, Predator, fuck. Excellent movie. I actually saw Predator late in the game, and it's everything it's cracked up to be. It's awesome. So yeah, where'd we leave off? Limey.
Yeah, so one thing I thought was interesting, and it's one of the cutesy little things. I don't know if you want to fast forward to what actually happened to the daughter yet.
Yeah, whatever.
So he, yeah, so what's his name?
Peter Fonda?
Wilson is tracking down Peter Fonda, who's Valentine or Valentine,
Terry
and
Valentine.
they. Yeah, so they track him up because he fled out of town and ends up killing all his boys. Pretty sweet. And ends up confronting him and asking what really happens. And what really happened was she was going to drop the dime on him and he accidentally broke her neck. But earlier in the movie, they were talking about how when she was a little girl, she would threaten to call the cops on her dad. Like, wow. Yeah, she really shouldn't have done that, shouldn't, huh? Like, even as a little kid and then as an adult, like, yeah, wow. You really shouldn't ever snitch. So that's the message I'm taking away from it.
That's what you pulled out of all this.
Yeah. Like, wow. Guess she never grew out of that.
Well, that's a decidedly negative way to look at it, I guess, or pessimistic look at it.
I think of it as optimistic.
Yeah. Well, on the other flip side of that coin, if her dad would have listened to her and wouldn't have been fucking around, he would have still been around and she wouldn't have died and she would have had a dad in her life. So you can take it that
Well,
way too. And the same thing with Terry Valentine. If he would have been like, all right, yeah, I'm gonna clean up and I'm not gonna get involved with this.
he said it was too late though.
Yeah.
Whatever deal she was trying to get him to call off, he's like, I already did it, so I'm gonna kill you now.
Yeah. We fixed the glitch. Yeah, I agree. The DAA part is kind of, I mean, I think they had to fit that in somewhere though, for like an additional source of heat and to like maybe legitimize the fact that like yeah he was involved in something which is ties into like his motive and pointing out like yeah he is a piece of shit and he's willing to just kill someone. He calls it an I accidentally broke her neck. Like no, you had the fear on you and you had you felt the walls coming in and like you felt like you had to do that to because you're a narcissist and you wanted to get away with it and keep on being the way that you've always been. But it does kind of feel a little shoehorned a little bit.
I think they finished this badass movie and they're like, well, we have an hour and 13 minutes. So let's just pepper in, 'cause this movie barely gets to like an hour 25, right?
Yeah, it's pretty brisk.
It's pretty short. So they probably just got to the end and thought, we need 12 minutes of just nothingness to fill in here somewhere. So let's get the guy from Predator and we'll just make up a little sub story to explain how to evade the assassins, how he was able to get into the country, and just throw an extra little bit of storyline in there. But who knows?
Yeah, and I guess speaking to like the quick runtime and like how it was filmed, so I guess I read part of a Rolling Stone article. It was like a 20 it was from 2019. It was a 20-year anniversary retrospective where Soderbergh came and sat down and talked to about this movie. And I guess the first cut of the film, they shot it and they edited it completely like a linear film. So it was like point A to point B. It didn't have all the choppy, the flash forwards, flashbacks, kind of side present things that are happening simultaneously that they're all melding together. It was completely linear, and I guess at the end, the director Soderbergh was looking at his editor and was like, "Fuck, this doesn't work as a linear film," which is interesting to think about how different this film would be if it was shot that way and actually released that way. So I guess at the very end of everything, editing, mastering the film, whatever, he basically started from scratch and completely re-edited the film, which added on, I don't know, another 2, 3, 4 months of editing. Because one of the things I think I like the most, and you touched on this too, is all those flashbacks, flash forwards. It's pretty unique. I can't really, I mean, there's some traces of it actually in The Prestige, the first film. Check back episode one in the archives that we covered. The flashbacks and the flash forwards and how that like Christopher Nolan does it. Did you get that similar vibe, like the way that they edited?
I didn't think about it at the time, but now that you mention it, I could see the similarity.
In this film, they do it. It's way more like on rails. Like it's quicker. It's the way the editing style is way faster than in the Prestige, the way that they're like, it's almost like they're sandwiched together. Because, and one thing I was thinking about too is that's another thing. If you examine it a little bit too closely, I think it loses its luster. Because I was thinking about it, like, there's multiple conversations where Wilson is having with this other gal who basically serves as like exposition and like a kind of like a character that's leading him around, like it's his tour guide through LA and trying to figure out what happened with his daughter and retracing her steps and getting up to the climbing the ladder to figure out, it's Terry Valentine, Peter Fonda's character. He's having multiple conversations with her that seem seamless, but they're flashing back and he's talking about something and it's all happening like in real time. This is really hard to describe in just like an audio medium, but like, it's like, imagine like a conversation you and I are having right now, but part of what I just said was like fucking 8 hours ago, and then part of what I'm about to say next happened a day later, and then there's shit we're talking about right now, and it's like edited all in line, like we're having one conversation. Do you see what I'm trying to get at?
I get what you're saying. Yes.
So part of that, like, I think, like, when you're watching it and you're just taking it in as like an experience and listening, it's like, oh yeah, it makes sense. He's talking about this and this, and it's seamless. But in reality, if you broke it apart, I guess they could have talked about this thing the day previous, and then they're talking about this other thing the day later, and it could still tie into what they're working on or what they're talking about, but it would seem really disjointed. Like, they just start talking about one thing, like, oh yeah, she was here and she was doing this, but then why would you come back to that a day later? Wouldn't you finish your thought, you know, that you're talking about right then? I don't know. I'm probably not describing it well. Audio listeners are probably like, what the fuck is he talking about? But
I think mushrooms are skin. One thing that I'm embarrassed to admit was how long into the movie it took me to finally decide that Valentine's girlfriend was not his daughter. I kept thinking, like, is it possible that the daughter's still alive? And because they kind of looked similar to me.
Yeah.
And so I don't know, maybe half the movie I was like, maybe this is the daughter, which I think is just a stupid thing to think. But
yeah, they don't go out of their way to make that clear. I think the biggest thing for me, obviously, is having seen it more times than you, but also it jumped out to me pretty early that it wasn't her, because Wilson's daughter who was murdered, she has blonde hair, or like maybe dirty blonde, and the new gal that fills her space, that Valentine shacked up with, I'm pretty sure she has like really dark brown or black hair. So though that part kind of cleared that up for me real quick.
Good for you.
Well, good for Happy Gilmore, my God.
Check out the big brain on Brad.
Just to interject to maybe a downshift, I found this quote researching this film a little bit that I feel is pretty dead nuts to how I feel about it. Is so this author, William Gibson, who is famous for like Neuromancer, he's like, people have called him like the father of like cyberpunk.
I don't know what most of those words mean.
Like, so you think about,
you don't need to explain it. You don't even need to explain it.
Well, just real quick. So you think about Blade Runner, that's like cyberpunk.
Yeah.
Okay. So that's your, that's your foundation. So,
it means shitty movie. Got it.
Rain drenched LA dystopian. Oh,
God.
Gotcha. Technology.
So that type of like style or whatever.
Yeah. So So his quote about this film was, I loved the limey. It's so violent! ! And yet it's so exquisitely romanticized in a sort of Japanese way. It's a samurai film. Coming out of that, I was really deeply conflicted, because a friend who had seen it said, it's beautiful, but it's not about anything. It's 1 micron thick. I was like, huh? Yeah. Cause I mean, it is violent as shit, but it doesn't really like zoom in on that. And it is kind of romanticized like a samurai film. Like, it does feel like this dude's kind of like a stoic, like he's got nothing to lose. He's old. He's been in and out of prison his whole life. It's like his last thing that he can do to like bring some good to his life is like, I don't know, honoring his daughter's legacy, maybe making up for all the time that he lost with her by making things right, by fulfilling this revenge porn of killing the dude that took her out.
Finally being a good dad for once in his life.
Yeah. And then, but yeah, it is, it said it's beautiful, but it's not about anything. It's super, you know, it gets right down to brass tacks. And I think that goes back to, you know, the more, if you really examine it too close, it does lose its luster, and it is, I mean, it's a pretty simplistic plot for the most
Yeah,
part.
it's IHOP. It's very simple.
Yeah. That makes me think. I love Jim Gaffigan's thing about IHOP. He's like, they shouldn't call it IHOP. When I get done out of there, it's like, I don't, they should call it, I don't want to get up. I don't want to hop. Yeah, but I found that quote and I was like, oh, that's pretty much how I feel about it too. But I don't know. I think when I saw this in probably the early 2000s, I think I probably saw this first time in 2001, so a couple of years after it released. It wasn't on my radar at all. I just saw it, and I think I noticed that it was directed by Steven Soderbergh, and I had seen Sex, Lies, and Videotape, and I liked his style, and I just checked it out, and I was like, whoa, I hadn't seen anything like that before. And I was like 18, 17 at the time when I saw this, and it just kind of stuck with me. So, couple of notes I wrote down, and maybe in hindsight, I don't know how on this is, but stream of consciousness when I was watching this, I wrote, it's shot kind of like a Wes Anderson movie. Lots of scenes that aren't shot like as a fixed point. There's the quote unquote present being portrayed while being interspersed with shots and scenes inaudibly at times, from the past, moments directly preceding or that follow the current quote unquote present scene. I like how they interspersed some of the stuff where it's like a flashback with zero context and it's inaudible, like there's no one speaking, but you can kind of pick up on what's happening. So like to the point you talked about, you know, like the daughter always threatening to call the cops or whatever. Before Wilson explains that happened, you can pick up on that because it's like a scene of the little girl, her as a the daughter is a little girl picking up the phone and she's like crying and she's like yelling and the dad is like, you know, it's all inaudible and he's like waving his hands like saying like no, don't call him. Like you can pick up like through osmosis like what's happening. I like those little scenes that they kind of sprinkled in. And I guess jumping off to a piece of trivia that I thought was pretty interesting, I was like, because they sprinkle in these flashbacks of Wilson, Terrence Stamp's character, when he's a fucking young buck. And at the time, it's
Oh.
like 1999, it's like there's no way they could have done at this time, like, and with the budget, this kind of the kind of movie this is, there's no way they did like CGI effects or like de-aging or anything crazy. I was like, was this like deleted scenes from an old movie or something that they got the rights to and then they interspersed, and that's pretty much what it was. So all the flashback footage of Terrence Stamp as like a 25-year-old, 30-year-old man are from the 1967 film Poor Cow, which is Ken Loach's directorial debut, that features flashbacks of Wilson, Terrence Stamp, with his baby daughter and wife. So I thought that was pretty interesting that they actually went out of their way to like find something that would line up in the story with his age. And they were able to buy the rights from another movie and intersperse a completely different
Well,
movie into this film.
that was the first thing I looked up when I was done because I thought that was a really cool thing that they did. And there was still a small part of me was like, maybe they were able to do that with just hair dye and some makeup. 'Cause when they showed him as an old man, when it would kind of flash back and forth, I was trying to picture, could they make this guy look younger? And the thing that gave it away most for me was like just the kind of older skin around his neck. So then when they flash back to the old scene, he's wearing like a turtleneck. I was like, oh shit, maybe this is just like really good makeup and costume and hair or whatever. So then when it was over, I looked it up and it's like, oh no, it's from this old movie, whatever. But the thing I saw said that whoever made that original movie, the director went to and was like, hey, do you mind if I use some scenes from that movie as for footage in this movie, and they said no, and he's like, fine, then I'll never work with you ever again. And there, then whoever was a part of the original movie was like, okay, fine, you can use the footage. So I thought that was really interesting too.
Damn, yeah, just fucking put nuts on the table and strong-armed him.
Yeah.
Right on.
At least that's what I read. I didn't call anybody or...
You didn't verify this through a third party?
Just one source.
Okay. Yeah, I liked that a lot. That's pretty cool. I think that adds to the
I don't think I've ever seen anything like that before.
No, I was thinking there's something similar, but nothing quite like this. I know one thing. So, you know, Fight Club?
Yeah.
You've seen Fight Club? There's a part where at the very end, you know, when Edward Norton tries to kill himself and shoots himself in the mouth.
Yeah.
At the very end. And, like, there's, like, smoke or there's, like, something coming out of his mouth.
Mm-hmm.
From the gunshot, I guess that is, or no, not that. It's the when he's having those weird fucking like psychic driving like dreams, and there's the fucking penguin, and it's all slide, like when they're talking about find your power animal, and he's in that like cold like Antarctic thing, and he's
the cave thing.
Yeah, his breath, it's like you can see, it's like super cold. They recycled that from like cold breath from Titanic, the very end of the film when everyone's in the water and freezing. They fucking they recycled those visual effects and put them into Fight Club. And then there's another in Blade Runner that we talked about that the original theatrical cut at the very end, they recycled some footage from some other goddamn film where they're driving, like the happy ending, they're driving through the countryside. They took that completely from a different film, but you wouldn't know that unless you like read about it. Cause it doesn't show any actors. There's no dialogue or anything. It's just like an aerial, like a helicopter shot of like a car driving away. So, but yeah, that is a unique thing about the Limey too.
The Blade Runner thing. I can't remember if we talked about it at the time or if I was curious, so I looked it up later, but the footage of them driving, I think they took that from The Shining.
You know that I can't say, yeah, I remember that, but that sounds familiar.
Yeah. The beginning of The Shining when they're driving up to the
overlook.
Otherwise I might be confusing something.
That's
not possible.
Yeah. That's echoes of that ring true. But yeah, I really like this film. So, I mean, we kind of beat around the bush about it. You said kind of like the latter half lost you a little bit and you liked the beginning. So overall, you enjoyed it or lukewarm?
I liked it. I would say a solid B for sure.
Okay.
I was definitely into it early. It started to lose me a little bit, but then even at like letting it sort of ferment a little bit after watching it, it's sort of I enjoyed it more with a little bit of time afterwards to sort of mull it over, because yeah, I mean, there was a little bit of a, it just kind of felt like something was missing, you know. It mm-hmm. checked a lot of boxes for me and I really liked it, but it kind of felt like whatever quote that was you read, just a little sort of, I don't know, shallow. Like it was, I don't know. It just kind of felt like it was missing something, but I did enjoy it. I would recommend it. I kind of just wish it was more kind of like more violent or more like the beginning, mm-hmm. you know, just kicking ass. And I really liked the creative, like we talked about.
Yeah.
Cinematography stuff. And I could have dealt less with some of the like second half stuff, but yeah, when he comes to the house at the end, and I thought it was weird that the two assassins went there too to try to just kill everybody. Like, all right, well. And then I wish they would have shown at the end whether or not he killed him after he got the information from him. Other than that, I don't really have anything to complain about. I liked it.
Right on. Yeah, I would agree. I think in hindsight, I wish it would have. It does feel like it's missing one, maybe one thing, a little spice to it. Maybe if it was a little bit more violent, or if it would have maybe not dragged so much in the beginning, or not the beginning, like the middle to like the two-thirds point. I really did like the. I hated Terry Valentine's, like his weird like head of security guy. In like
I like that guy.
the brown suit, something about him I just didn't. I liked to not like him also, but like the scene where they go to that like house party that he's having up in like the Hollywood Hills or wherever it was, and he goes and you the way they shoot it, like it's in the background like 100 yards away, so in the foreground you see Peter Fonda just like schmoozing, have wine and drinks, and he's talking with somebody. And then you see Wilson in the background approach this big fat, like another one of his security guard lackeys. And they're up on this big, like, I don't know, cliff face.
Balcony sort of thing.
Yeah. And it looks like it could be 50 feet or 200 feet up in the air. But anyway, you see him kind of like they're talking, and they're 100 yards like in the background, but it's still in focus so you can see what's happening. And he goes and he just picks up this like 250-pound man and throws him off this fucking cliff. And like at first, people are like shocked. They don't know if it's like a gag. And like people kind of like turn and like they're like, did that guy just throw him off a fucking 100-foot cliff? And like that's when shit starts getting wild, and then they got to get out of there. And that dude, like, they ram his car, and he's got like that fucking pistol grip, pump
Yeah,
shotgun.
shot shotgun.
I love that whole scene too. Is really cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, maybe if they would
This
have
is
another scene like that, or if they would have paced it a little bit better, towards the end. Because it kind of does devolve into one of those flicks where it's like, okay, like the last quarter of the film, it's like, the last stand kind of thing. Like he goes into his like hiding place in the redwoods, and like he's gonna hold up, and like he's got a security around him, like he's his impenetrable fortress. And sure shit, he comes in and starts just taking people out and works his way up to it's just the final standoff. And it does kind of fall a little bit flat because that's outside of his character to not seal the deal and just put a bullet in this guy's fucking head. Like it's like kind of what I think what we alluded to just before this off the air. It's like, maybe it was their attempt at showing like, oh, he's finally grown. And it's like, it's not about the revenge. It's about getting closure. Like the he knew what happened to his daughter, and then that final act of like mercy or whatever you want to call it is him having growth as a character. Like he doesn't need to spill over into like the criminal part of his life that is what robbed him of all those years with his daughter.
And if
I don't
that's
know.
the case, I think that's kind of lame because it's
Yeah.
like of all of the action leading up to that, it's like this would be the most justified you could ever be into just
Right.
killing this guy who's like, yeah, it wasn't a car accident. I actually murdered your daughter
Yeah, that's
because
where I th
she.
yeah, it's 'cause it's so outside of his character. It's like, yeah, that does feel a little cheap to
Well, and
just
in that speech he gave early on or earlier on where he was talking about, I think he was talking about in prison, he's like, you just have to bide your time. You have to be patient. You can't just lash out and attack somebody whenever you want. You have to bide your time. And so when he finally gets to him at the end, it's like, all right, he's been biding his time. Like it's now, he wanted to kill him at that party. It's like, how would you not want to kill him 1,000 times more now? I mean,
Right.
maybe if the truth was like a rival gang member killed her, because I got her mixed up in something. That's one thing, but it's like, oh no, I broke her neck and then we burned the shit out of her to try to cover it up. So sorry. It'd be really hard for him to be like, oh, all right, well, thanks for telling me. I just killed everybody else in your group, but
But yeah, I'm gonna spare you And that's somehow
be cool
gonna...
if he left him there hobbled and just waited for like the high tide to come in or something.
Yeah.
Go extra cruel on his ass.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that maybe that would have gone a long way to bring it home, and because it does feel a little disingenuous, like that act of mercy is somehow like elevating him or something. I don't know. That's just speculation.
They don't show one way or the other, so that's also a little irritating. It's like, okay, well, if you don't want to show him killing him or not killing him, can you please just address if he did or not, you know?
Yeah. All right. Well.
You got any other fun facts, or you want to wrap this bad boy?
I think we're pretty close to wrapping it, but... I guess one little tidbit we mentioned out of sight earlier. There's a scene in the film where Peter Fonda is watching TV, and it's got George Clooney in it. I can't remember what the show is, but he was in.
I think it was like an Entertainment Tonight or something. Something just in the background, like one of those entertainment shows, and they're like, George Clooney is blah blah blah.
Yeah, so that just kind of, it's like a character or a director trademark because he's worked so much with Clooney in the past. Let's see. Oh, yeah. So Steve and I both worked with someone who our former boss was British. And I'm kind of enamored with like British shit, namely... Cockney rhyming slang. Are you familiar with that at all?
Yeah, Christ. I was wondering how much of this, because you're such like a lingo person. You love stupid little quips and rhymes, and yeah, that's definitely your little Asperger thing showing itself. And so there were so many times throughout this movie I was thinking like, oh God, I bet Gwenza just loves that. When he's like, I'm going to go have a butcher. And she's like, what the fuck are you talking about? He's like, butcher's hook. I'm going to go take a look. Like, oh yeah, sorry. I didn't make that connection. That makes no sense. It's not intuitive at all. It made me think of the guy in Ocean's 11 where he's like, oh, if this happens, we're in Barney.
Yeah.
Barney Rubble. Trouble. Like, that is not an ABC. You couldn't stepping stone your way there. Those are three complete, like, non sequitur. Anyway, go ahead. Yeah, I'm sure you loved it.
Yeah. Yeah, that's where my tinges of the tism come into play for sure.
Oh, God. I rolled my eyes so hard every time that happened. Like, oh, God. Is that like a common thing, or is that just kind of put on?
No, it's a real thing, but I think it's kind of antiquated nowadays. I think it's like nowadays it's not used very much. I think it's similar. The way I interpret it is it's the level of slang like for American people. It's like super deep South, like Southernisms that are just kind of like a vestige of a previous time. They're not really, they're antiquated, you know? So, but the history of it is actually really interesting. So like Cockney rhyming slang, it was developed, and it makes sense that this guy uses it in the modern day when this was filmed in 99, because of like his class, his station in life, people still use Southernisms. Right. So, but they're not, it's like a rarity type of thing, but it has roots in something like functional. So Cockney rhyming slang, it was, and it ties into his character too, because he's a lifer in and out of prison. He's a thief, those kinds of things. It was used in the UK, in Britain, as a way of like talking in code. So people wouldn't know what you're talking about, like your next job, or like, we're going to meet here. I'm probably fucking it up a little bit, but it's basically a way to disguise what you're talking about, and then it's just out of that, it's like slang. It's just like a fun way to talk, and like, so like in the film, and you alluded to it already. It's like this. It's this weird rhyming thing, and it's like if you don't know it, you wouldn't know what. So he has to explain it. Like he's like, the gal that he's palling around with, she's like Eddie. He's like, yeah. He's like my new China, Eduardo, Louis Guzman's character. And she's like China. What the fuck are you talking about? And he's like, China plate mate. So like that's his new buddy. Like that's his friend. Yeah. So that's how you get there. So it's like, the first word is like you don't know what the fuck they're talking about. The second word is the rhyme. The second word rhymes with the third word that's hidden that isn't spoken aloud. So when you say China, China rhymes, you're saying China plate. Plate rhymes with mate, the unspoken word. That's what it is. So when you say, oh yeah, that's my new China, that's my new mate, that's my new friend. Same thing when he goes into the fucking warehouse and he's like, yeah, oh, yeah, you gotta worry about tea leaves. And he's like, tea leaves? What the fuck are you talking about? He's like, tea leaves, thieves. You gotta worry about thieves. And when I brought this, when I found out we had a boss that was from Britain, I'm pretty sure one of the first fucking things I said to him, I was like, have you ever seen the Limey? Yeah.
Yeah. Oh my God.
Yeah. I was like, hey, have you ever seen the Limey? He's all great film. Great.
Oh really?
Yeah. He loves it. He loves this fucking movie. Then I went, I was like, okay, tism tingling. Yeah. And I was like,
do you know that guy?
Yeah, no. I was like, do you know like the Cockney rhyming slang? Like, and he's like, yeah. Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. And he's like, you know, people ask you about your wife or something, like how that's going, and they'd say, how is it with the trouble? And he's like, trouble and strife, wife. Like that's what. So like, if you heard like one of these guys are talking shit or whatever, and they're talking about trouble, they're talking about their wife. You know, I just thought it was really interesting, like how they get to there, and like, yeah, like the butcher's hook.
Yeah.
I'm going to go take a look. Cause I think that's probably the most common one. Like, oh, I'm going to go have a butcher's around, you know, and look. And I was like, what the fuck is a butcher's, you know? So later in life I figured out, oh, that's what they're talking about. This Cockney rhyming slang shit. And I went down a Wikipedia K hole one day, like 5 years ago, and like, figured out like the history of it.
Speaking of K-hole, did you happen to see there's a picture that this guy posted on like Twitter or something, I don't know, and he was down at a resort in Mexico and he came back to the room and housekeeping, it was a guy, had found his bag of ketamine, but he thought it was cocaine, and so he snorted a line of it.
Oh fuck.
And it's definitely a visual thing, but he took a picture of this guy who's like laying on his bed alive, but his eyes are just like blasted open. And he's like, this guy's deep in a K hole right now. I'm not sure what I'm supposed to do, but the look on this guy's face is hilarious.
Dude.
Wasn't sure if you'd seen that.
No.
Somewhere in Mexico. If anybody listening wants to try to use Google to figure out, or to try to find that picture, because yeah, it was crazy. Like, well, just got back to my room and this guy thought it was cocaine, and he's turned himself into a puppet and he's just laying on the bed like,
yeah. Yeah, I guess like the corollary to that would be like, you know, you think of Pulp Fiction when Uma Thurman finds the baggie in John Travolta's coat and she thinks it's coke and it's heroin, she fucking ODs. So mm-hmm. Yeah. Never good to assume with the powdery stuff. Ketamine, actually, someone who isn't me did that one time, and they described it like you're standing like maybe 5 feet behind you and then slightly off to the right, and you're watching yourself in like third person interact throughout the world.
Strange.
Which is...
Because it's like a... It's like a horse tranquilizer, right?
I know they give it to animals for something, and it has effects. But yeah, that's all I know about ketamine other than the parlance of using K-hole. Yeah, I think that's gonna wrap this up for the Limey. I love this film. I like it a lot. I think when I saw it at such a young age, when I was developing, it kind of like hit me. It was like out of nowhere. Wasn't expecting what it was, and I hadn't seen anything like that up to that point. And it is pretty unique film in certain or in some respects, and I highly recommend it. It sounds like you got something out of it. At least it was an
Yeah,
entertaining
it's
watch,
fun.
and it's not a
It's fun.
slog.
It's
Like you said, it's pretty brisk too, so.
Yeah, I wouldn't put it in the category of if I found out somebody hadn't watched it, like, oh, you've got to watch it. I would almost equate it to like a movie like The Equalizer or something where it's like, don't go into it expecting gourmet meal. It's like junk food. It's like a bag of chips. You'll enjoy it, absolutely, but
Yeah, I
enjoy it for
mean,
what it is.
yeah, your analogy of Chili's is pretty on. Like, I'm not a big fan of Chili's, but for sure when they bring over a sizzling thing of fucking Chili's fajitas, I'm a happy boy, that's for sure. So,
Yeah. The chips and salsa are underrated, I will say.
you know what I think is underrated, and I haven't seen them. I feel like they've just been going away slowly more and more, is Chevy's. Are you a fan of Chevy's?
No, it's absolute dog shit.
Really?
I'm happy they're going away for everyone's sake.
There's a
But yes,
Chevy.
I have noticed the same thing. They're dwindling,
Yeah.
thankfully.
One thing I noticed out
People
here.
are waking up.
How
For
dare you?
those who have never had the displeasure, Chevy's is like shitty Tex-Mex
It's
Applebee's.
delicious. It's delicious. Get out of here.
Funny story, went to a baseball game with a few of our old coworkers, and on the way back, there's a Chevy's that's right off the freeway, so it's pretty convenient. And this waiter was like the dumbest fucking guy I've ever talked to in my life. Everybody's ordering and it's going pretty normal. And I was like, I think I'll get the nachos. And he's like, well, you know, that's just chips, right? I was like, well, there's stuff on it, right? He's like, well, yeah, but I mean, it's just chips. I'm like, yeah, I know. Nachos. He's like, okay. And we walked away, and in my head, I'm like, oh God, what kind of nightmare is this guy going to bring back over here?
What do you mean by that?
But yeah, so he brought back normal nachos, ate like half of it, felt like shit, fell asleep on the drive home. It was an awful evening.
Thought you were going to say fell asleep at the wheel.
No, I wish. That was like one of the worst meals I've ever had.
You know, that's just chips, right? Jesus
Yeah.
Christ.
Yep. You even have a handy picture of it in the menu.
Boy, I wish I had something to knock your ass out with. I'll knock
Yeah.
your ass out.
All right.
Yep.
It's funny out here in Northeast Indiana, they have a knockoff Chevy's and it's spelled with two V's. Chevy's.
Weird.
It's like the same exact logo and font, just with two V's, and it's a Mexican restaurant. So,
Weird.
I haven't been bold enough to check that out yet. But all right, well that's gonna wrap this up. Oh shit, I completely forgot. We actually got our first email to the wax at waxingtheporpoise.com. If anybody has any comments or wants to talk about anything that we're doing, send us an email at wax at waxingthepurpose.com.
Is it hate mail?
No,
Damn
surprisingly
it. Is it from
enough.
my mom?
No, it's not. I
Oh,
wish.
damn it. Okay. Yeah.
That'd be a fun read.
Yeah.
I have no frame of reference. I don't know anything about your mom, but it'd be fun nonetheless. Just knowing about her, just like giving us notes. This is a really great thing you guys have going on.
Yeah. So, I wish she wouldn't curse so much.
Yeah. I was going to say, like, how much is this making her ticker speed up? We actually, so there's a now, I don't know if defunct is the appropriate way to say it, but
sacrilege.
Yeah. Number four. there's a podcast that is, it's no longer active. But it's called the Channel 83 podcast, which is mainly horror. It's really in-depth, got a lot of obscure Asian horror. It's the guy's forte. His name's Chris. He no longer does the podcast. He's branching into some other things. But I came across his podcast a couple years ago and really dug it. It's a one-man show, and there's not very many I listen to a lot of pod, and I think you do too. There's not very many that can nail a one-man podcast and have it be interesting and to stay up on it with. But this guy did it. He had a one-man show, and it's called Channel 83. I'm pretty sure it's still active on all the, you know, the main podcatchers. So you can definitely go check it out. I was a fan of the show, and I actually wrote him an email about his show and commented on it, and he read it on one of his episodes, and so he returned the favor, and this is our first email. So this is from Chris at Channel 83. He said, "Hey guys, Jim sent me my first email when I started my podcast, so it only seems fitting that I send you guys your, hopefully, first email as well. Enjoying the show so far. On the subject of Black Rain, there's actually a Japanese film that is also called Black Rain that is also from 1989. It is about the aftermath of the Hiroshima bombing and is adapted from the 1966 book Black Rain. I haven't gotten around to watching it, but it has been sitting on my Plex ever since Jim introduced me to the Michael Douglas Black Rain. Also related, for whatever reason, there was a spate of these East meets West films in the 1980s to the 1990s, and I'm wondering if you've seen any of the other ones like American Yakuza with Viggo Mortensen, or Kinjite with Charles Bronson. If not, definitely check out at least Kinjite. It's probably the most unhinged Bronson / J. Lee Thompson collab. The episode where Steve talked about applying his trade was interesting, and I would definitely like to hear more. I like the use of the term degenerate gambler to distinguish between advantage players and gambling addicts. Big Tony Soprano vibes. Keep up the good work, Chris, from Channel 83 and Podgasari, which I'm assuming is one of his new projects that he's working on. So thanks, Chris. Good to hear from you, and appreciate the notes and the love for the show. To answer the question, I'm not familiar with American Yakuza with Viggo Mortensen, but I definitely like him as an actor a lot, so I'll be checking that out. But speaking of Kinjite,
both those movies are actually really good.
You've seen both of those?
No, I haven't.
You fucking asshole! I should have known. But yeah, Kinjite with Charles Bronson. I mean, you had me at most unhinged Bronson, so I will definitely be checking that out.
That sounds good. Yeah, I like that.
Fuck yeah. Have you ever seen any of the Death Wish movies with Charles Bronson?
No.
Dude, they are right up your fucking alley. They're awesome. They're like dog shit. I mean, I think the first three are the highest quality. I think there's like five or six Death Wishes. They're fucking awesome. There's one where he's mopping, like vigilante style, mopping up the streets of New York, and he shoots a dude with a bazooka no less than like 6 feet in front of him, and he just goes, it's that kind of movie. So I think you would like it.
Nice. But
anyway, thanks again, Chris, for the input, and the end of that too, talking about the card counting episode, episode 9. If you haven't checked it out, check it out. We've actually gotten some really good feedback on that episode. So I think we're definitely going to push forward and do a part 2, because I mean, we just ran short on time, and there was a lot of stuff that, I still had questions about too. And others have also offered a couple questions that we can incorporate into the mix. And I definitely think there's plenty of meat left on that bone, that we can get at if you're game.
Yeah. And if anybody has any questions, feel free to send them in.
Yeah.
Not sure if you can hear my cat. She made her first appearance this episode.
Yeah, it's pretty late. I was going to say, what's going on?
She's been napping.
Oh, okay. Well, yeah. So we're definitely going to do another episode. I don't know if it'll be probably in the next, within the next two or three episodes we release will be a part two of Advantage Play. So we'll get into that. Shoot us an email, or you can also reach us at our socials, Instagram, Waxing the Porpoise, or Twitter at Waxing the Porp. Any final thoughts? Anything else you got going on you want to talk about before we close this thing up?
No, I don't think so.
All righty. Well, that was a fun discussion. I look forward to the next episode. I don't know what we're going to talk about next. I had grand plans to, like, I feel like we need to change it up a little bit and get into, like, some kind of like a funky true crime or something unexplained. Did you have anything off that list that we have, that patchwork list that we have, or if there's anything recent that you've come across that might be intriguing?
I saw some article about how people don't think Antarctica is real, and they think it's like some, I saw a lot of different things that it's speculated as being used for, and I bookmarked it, haven't read it. It just seemed like something that might be up your alley. And we haven't talked about this yet, but I'm sure you're familiar with some of the tinfoil hattery surrounded Antarctica.
Tinfoiled hattery.
Yep.
Yes. I think that specifically is a new one on me. I think I've heard inklings of that on along the lines of like flat earth shit, which I don't really want to get into, but I mean,
are you scared of the truth?
Yeah. Antarctica is a fucking bag, a whole other bag of cats, and there's a bunch of different shit tied to it. I am really interested in, although it's kind of been done a lot, is like the inner earth. You've heard that kind of stuff?
Yeah. Like hollow earth stuff?
Inner earth, like the entrance to hollow earth at the north and south poles. Antarctica's got a lot of weird shit going on, and there's a lot of far reaching, like the spectrum on that is huge, but I haven't heard anything specifically about its lack of existence. Except when you start talking about like the firmament and then I start like alarm bells and it's flat earth and it's like, get me out of here. But I am intrigued by like the inner earth. I think we talked about before we started this podcast, there's a really interesting case of, it was Operation High Jump, which is, pretty famous now. It's almost mainstream. It's Admiral Byrd. They led an expedition there in like the 40s, maybe late 30s. Some high strangeness there for sure, but it actually ties closely into supposedly, like, this is our neck of the woods, Mount Shasta. Have you ever heard about Lemurians? They're supposedly...
I've heard that people think it's like an energy portal or some bullshit, but
yeah, supposedly there's like other, like, kind of, you start getting into like ley line kind of stuff and like magic, and like some people think
magic,
like, some people think like, you know, the Lemurians and Mount Shasta, like that's another opening to the inner earth. So yeah, I don't know if we'll get that far or go into that, but I guess we'll just leave this podcast. This episode, we'll leave it open-ended, and we'll figure it out. And the next episode will be a surprise. So we'll just figure that out.
We'll just do it live.
We'll do it live. I think I fucking scrapped all those bumps.
Chase, what the fuck were you thinking about here?
All right. Well, that's going to do it for us. Join us next week. We'll have a new episode on something super dope.
Yep.
Thanks for joining us, and we will catch you next time. Bye.
Mr. Son of a Beach, let's play some cards.